All right, good afternoon. Try that again. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a little better. All right, I'm Gerald Mitchell. I'm the president and CEO of the Greater Columbus Chamber of Commerce. Welcome to CSU and the Cunningham Center for this year's State of the City presented by Paige Graham. We're so glad that you have joined us today for this event that brings together business leaders and the city's top elected officials and administrators to hear Mayor Skip Henderson give you an update on the city. We also want to say hello to everyone that has tuned in on CCG TV. As the city manager would say, you're now watching CCG TV. The Columbus Chamber is proud to host this annual event, which is made possible by the generous support of our partners and sponsors. In addition to Paige Graham, as the presenting sponsor of the State of the City, we're receiving support at the gold level from AT&T, Georgia Power, Liberty Utilities, and we also have silver and welcome sponsors or supporters. We also want to thank our cornerstone investors, Aflac, Georgia Power, Piedmont Columbus Regional, Synovus, TSIS, a global payments company, and W.C. Bradley. Again, they enable so much that we're able to do on an ongoing basis. Cornerstone investors are essential to all of the Chamber's annual efforts, and we appreciate, again, that support as we work to lead the Columbus region as a catalyst for growth, economic opportunity, business strength, and community engagement. We would also like to welcome the members of our Columbus City Council. The City Council members would stand, please. Thank you for your service and commitment to the citizens of Columbus. I'd also like to acknowledge the City Manager, Isaiah Hughley, Deputy City Managers, Lisa Goodwin and Pam Hodge. Will you all stand as well as the department heads? Also in attendance today from Fort Benning is Major General Curtis Buzzard. General Buzzard. He's over here on this side of the room. Thank you so much for your leadership and for being here with us. In addition, we've got the Garrison Commander, Colonel Colin Malley. And the Special Assistant to the Commanding General, Mr. Mike Burns. So much for being here and for what you do to help our installation continue to thrive. I would also like to recognize Chris Kelly, representing Congressman Sanford Bishop's office. As well as Columbus State University's interim president and our host, Dr. John Fuchko. And lastly, there are 29 participants of this year's Leadership Columbus class. They're here with us along with their chair, Reggie Lewis. If you guys would all raise your hands to be acknowledged. And I'll add two more notes. One is any Chamber of Commerce or Development Authority board members. Again, if you're here, please stand. Again, I want to thank you guys for everything you do to help us continue to move our organization and the community forward as well. And now lastly, we've got a team at the Chamber of Commerce that in my opinion is second to none. And they help us, again, keep all of these things going to bring you guys quality product, events, you name it, just general support. I want to thank the team at the Chamber of Commerce. Once again, thank you all for being with us. It is now my pleasure to introduce Carter Schondemeyer. Carter is a native of Columbus and a litigation partner at Paige Graham, focusing on employment law. She has defended some of the area's largest private and governmental employees or employers in a variety of matters, including discrimination, sexual harassment, and wage and hour claims. She has also represented the Columbus Consolidated Government for the last several years. Please welcome to the stage, Carter Schondemeyer.
Thank you, H. Scranton. I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to sponsor this event. We are always appreciative of our relationship with the City of Columbus, as it has been a long-standing one. I'm here to introduce Mayor Skip Henderson, who has been a public servant of this community for almost 30 years. Prior to running for mayor, he served as the at-large city councilor for over two decades and spent almost 10 years as the chair of the budget committee for the city council. He became the 70th mayor of Columbus when he was elected in 2018, and he has just begun his second term in office. The mayor is a Columbus native, the son of Army veteran 30 years.
His wife, Marcella.
Prior to running for mayor, he served as the at-large city councilor for over two decades and spent almost 10 years as the chair of the budget committee for the city council. He became the 70th mayor of Columbus when he was elected in 2018, and he has just begun his second term in office. The mayor is a Columbus native, the son of Army veteran 30 years. Prior to running for mayor, he served as the at-large city councilor for over 2 years and spent almost 10 years as the chair of the budget committee for the city council. He became the 70th mayor.
This is not about an administration or a mayor or even a government. This is about us. This is our hometown. This is our community. This is the region that we live in. And that's what this is about. So as we talk about some things today, I'll tell you that every opportunity I have to participate in one of these means so much to me, because this is not about an administration, like a mayor, or even a government. This is about us. This is our hometown. This is our community. This is the region that we live in. And that's what this is about. So as we talk about some things today, I'll tell you that every opportunity I have to participate in one of these means so much to me, because this is not
and one of the great pleasures that I have had serving as your mayor, is I've had a front row seat for some of the most courageous and best leadership I've ever seen in my life, and that is the commanding generals that have come through Fort Benning. Going back to Jerry Brito, Major General Brito, and of course, Major General retired, emphasis on retired, Pat Donahoe, he is here. Pat, where are you? You raise your hand. And of course, Major General Buzzard, and I got to tell you, I have thoroughly enjoyed watching the leadership of his two predecessors, and as we get to know each other, I am completely impressed with his enthusiasm for blurring the line between the civilian world and the military world. And that's huge to us that are lifetime residents of Columbus, because we look at Fort Benning and Columbus as kind of an intertwinable DNA. And I just thank General Buzzard for being here. I know he has another engagement. It means a lot that you stopped in for a few minutes, sir. Also want to mention some of the hardest working folks that exist in our community, and that's your legislative body in the City Council. Delighted that Councilor Huff, Councilor Kogel, Mayor Pro Tem Allen could be here today. I'm telling you, no matter anything that we want to do, want to accomplish in Columbus, it's going to take some guardrails. It's going to take some legislation. It's going to take some input on policies. It comes from City Council. They do an incredible job. And also want to say again how honored I am to work with our city manager, Mr. Isaiah Hughley. I won't go through all of the staff that's here, but these folks, as tough as it got during COVID and during other challenges that we faced, these are the folks that kept the city going. And I cannot stress to you how difficult and what an amazing job that was. When you consider the challenges, and we'll talk about some of them, with regards to workforce, regards to supply lines, trying to get the services delivered to the people that live in Columbus, Georgia. So I just want to thank them again. Also want to point out, we left out one elected official, a longtime friend of mine, Mr. Greg Gant, who, Greg, if you'd stand up, he's on the County Commission Chair.
Depending on how this talk goes, he may really regret that I said we're longtime friends, but we are. We've known each other quite a while. And then, of course, I got to recognize my family again. Delighted that our daughter, Kyle, who drove, could be here. She drove in from Atlanta. Thank you, Peanut. And I want to also introduce McKenna, who this time next year will be McKenna Henderson. She is our son Joey's fiance, who is sitting there next to her. You can wave. Why she wants to join this wacky family, I don't know, but we are delighted that she's going to help balance it out. So I'm just grateful. Did I forget somebody? Oh yeah. I forgot to mention my wife, Karen, my best friend for the last 40 years. And Mike helped us pull off the ultimate, surprise on her for our 40th wedding anniversary, which is one of the coolest things I've ever done. Somebody said, did she cry? I said, I don't know. I was blubbering like a baby. I couldn't look at her. So, but honey, thank you for standing beside me. This is a team sport. You cannot serve. These folks up here know that you cannot serve in public office if you do not have a strong, supportive family that's going to have you back when you get home. So I thank you. All right. We have had a couple of different things occur, and this intro had a much different tone to it on Thursday than it does now. The gun violence that took place in our community and that wounded and injured 9 children in our community was horrific. And that incident, along with other incidents that occurred over the weekend, were tragic. They're unthinkable. You know, Karen and I, one of the few times we can just sit down, just the two of us, we do it early in the morning over a cup of coffee and we watch the news. And we'll see these events that transpire across the country and we're horrified. And our hearts go out to those individuals. And I can honestly tell you that if you ask her, I think she'll say the same thing. I never would have thought that we would have experienced something similar to that. But those events that occurred, they identified the fact, refocused on the fact that we have to act deliberately and very intentionally as a community. And we have to do so in order to create an environment where the culture begins to change in some of these young people that think that the only way to address any type of conflict or even an argument, let alone a fist fight, is by pulling a trigger. And the fact is that if the parents, it has coincided, the rise in violence in our country has coincided with the deterioration of the family. And if the family can't, and sometimes as bad as it sounds, if the family won't address these issues, then frankly, it's up to us. We can make a decision to ignore it and point out the fact that those children are running wild and getting guns and hurting people, or we can make a decision that we want to do what we can as a community to protect not only our family, but our community, and to put some boundaries around some of these young people that have yet to turn to those types of activities. So we have to make that choice. And we need to continue to put resources towards programming and towards organizations that are designed to provide opportunities for these young people. Because I talked to David Lewis. I forgot to mention David Lewis. See, I told you I'd forget somebody. Superintendent David Lewis, he and I were talking, and they have classes on handling and mitigating some of the frustration that kids feel and anger management. But then they go home. And whatever they see modeled at home is what's going to have the most impact on them. So we are going to have to continue to put resources towards those programs, but we also have to continue to support and put resources towards our law enforcement officers. Because for the individuals that won't abide by the rules that that are there, then the mission changes and it becomes a very intensive finding them, arresting them, and then locking them up for as long as we can. So it saddens me that we have to open this with that type of a discussion, and I'm sure we'll talk about it some more. I know Rodney's got some questions regarding public safety, and we'll touch on some of that in the meat of this as well. I do have to laud our law enforcement officers and our Columbus Fire and EMS, because when that event happened on Friday night, the first one of our ambulances arrived in 4 minutes, and the last young person arrived at the hospital 32 minutes later. So they did a phenomenal job, and only by the grace of God and some outstanding work from frontline medical personnel, as well as our EMS and our law enforcement who were tending to them with first aid for those first 4 minutes. Without that, we would have lost some of those kids. So, and you know, the crazy thing about stuff like that is they were not, at this point, that doesn't look like any of them were connected. I mean, there was no connection between all those things, other than you had somebody who had access to a gun who did not control their urge to fire that gun. That was the only thing they had in common. A couple of them started out as minor domestic disputes, ended up with people losing their lives. So that is a choice that we'll all have to make, and we'll all continue to work, and we'll urge our community members to get involved, and we'll have some ideas on how you can do that. You know, the challenge though is we do have, in Columbus, Georgia, we have so many good things going on. And it's not just in Columbus, it's in our entire region. It's up into Harris County, and it's over into across the river in Alabama. My friend Mayor Eddie Lowe constantly refers to it and says we're one region, and we are. In Fort Benning, Colonel Malley is part of that region. So we look forward to any opportunity to embrace the challenges that come with each new day, but we've got to really try to look for ways to work together, because the way the resources are diminishing, and as difficult as it's been to continue to move your community forward, we're going to have to embrace regionalism and really work on working together. So anyway, that's sort of the intro. It's not the one I had written on Thursday, but it is the one that we're faced with today. And this today, you know, the very first one of these I did, I stood up here and gave a speech. And I think because of that, Rodney says, let's do a sit down question and answer. So we're going to do sort of a hybrid. I do have a few things I want to share with you today, and then we're going to sit down. I'm going to let Rodney ask me some questions. But first, you guys are going to get a sneak preview at a video that was produced by CCGTV. It's only about 5 or 6 minutes long, and it's some of the good things that have happened throughout 2022. And it's a YouTube video, so a lot of them are screenshots of council meetings and things, but if we could, let's go, I think.
You know, it's hard to believe that we are in the second month of 2023. When we look back in our rearview mirror, we may have overlooked or missed some things that are great that took place for Columbus, Georgia in the year 2022. So let's take a look back. Here is a year in review for 2022. After going through 2 years of quarantine, distrust, and massive tragedy brought by a global pandemic, the world was praying that 2022 would be a return to normalcy. During that period, our mayor, council, and city manager worked tirelessly to keep Columbus, Georgia operating properly. As a matter of fact, not only did our city leaders keep us on track, but Columbus, Georgia was selected in the top 26 best managed cities within the USA, and this is how they did it. In January of 2022, Council approved the acquisition of the Synovus buildings to become the new home of Columbus Consolidated Government Operations. This purchase agreement consisted of acquiring and renovating 4 Synovus buildings, just under 250,000 square feet of office space, a 6-level parking garage with 634 parking lanes. In January 2022, Council approved hiring Evergreen Solutions to conduct an analysis of all CCG employee pay scales. After carefully analyzing and making adjustments, the CCG classification and compensation pay plan was adopted and approved by council, which resulted in significant pay increases for numerous CCG employees. In February 2022, Columbus Mayor and Council were presented with the results of an external audit. The FY21 annual financial report gave Columbus Consolidated Government not only passing grades, but proved we are financially stable for a government this size. As a matter of fact, we are able to fully operate our government for 120 days without additional funding based on the health of our fund balance. February also brought more good news to our city government by being again recognized with a DCA Plan First community designation. This recognition is based on city comprehensive plans such as the Dragonfly Trail, with benefits such as state and national recognition, reduction in interest rates for accessing fundings, which equates to more bang for the buck when funding local community projects. In April 2022, the Columbus Consolidated Government partnered with Uptown Columbus to find a permanent, more visible home for Katie the Cow. This giant structure was successfully relocated from its home off of Manchester Expressway to Woodruff Park off of the Riverwalk. This captivating cow is as Columbus as the Aflac Building, and the move was successfully done at no cost to our city government. In May of 2022, the City of Columbus designated $5 million in ARP funding, of which 127 small businesses were served, totaling $4,157,774. In addition, 27 nonprofits were served, totaling $595,847. This innovative program was recognized as a national best practice by the National Community Development Association. In June of 2022, Mayor and Council voted and approved to not only acknowledge Juneteenth as a paid holiday, but agreed to organize and support a week-long celebration with events throughout the city to help commemorate this historical national holiday. In July of 2022, the Mayor and Council helped cut the ribbon to officially open the doors to the new Robert S. Portishev VA Clinic in Columbus, Georgia. This new state-of-the-art facility offers advanced health care for approximately 25,000 veterans from throughout the Chattahoochee Valley and will shuttle and transport veterans between this clinic and the Tuskegee campus. Also in July of 2022, the Columbus Consolidated Government partnered with the Department of Defense and Valley Healthcare to put on an innovative readiness training. This annual event provided advanced trauma care training for the military and provided free medical care for local citizens that included wellness and health screenings, dental care, and veterinarian services. Council also approved to extend the Dragonfly Trails connector that connected Midtown to Uptown Columbus. Council voted and approved the public art display now present at the 11th Street Viaduct in Midtown Columbus. Another important purchase voted and approved for the comprehensive cameras. These cameras will be installed in three phases. They will be strategically placed in areas that are high crime, high security, and high traffic. Council voted and approved of acquisition and renovation of properties located at 1000 5th Street. This property will be the administrative offices of the Muskogee County Sheriff Department. July was a busy month of great happenings for our city. In July, Council also approved a $750,000 allotment for our Crime Prevention Department. This grant was distributed to 38 local organizations. The awards range from $5,000 to $60,000. The impact on the community directly involved up to 5,000 youth and adults. In October of 2022, Council approved the final design of the art display located on 18th Street. Previously, Council approved to partner with Columbus State University to come up with a concept and provide murals of art displayed in selected areas of Columbus. Also in October, Council approved to expand and create additional entertainment districts to include the Uptown Districts, the Highside Districts, and the Midland Common Districts. In December of 2022, Council approved to accept two grants totaling $1,800,000 for both the Liberty Theater and the Ma Rainey House. These funds will provide needed repairs and upgrades to improve operations for both locations. Council also approved to allow the Columbus Consolidated Government to take over and manage operations of the Liberty Theater. Last, but certainly not least, in December, Council approved to allocate $39 million for Phase 2 of the American Rescue Plan. This funding will be used for several CCG departments to provide upgrades, repairs, and much-needed purchases. What a year the Columbus Consolidated Government had. If you think 2022 was great, the mayor, council, and city manager are working tirelessly to make 2023 even better.
Afraid I'd leave out some of that, so I figured we'd let you guys get a sneak peek. I think that's going to end up on YouTube. Annual report from the City of Columbus will be coming out soon, and you'll see a lot of this information and even more detailed information in it. But you know, and I'm going to touch on some of those again, like I likely will as we go through this, because some of them I think are so significant. First off, I think is the ARPA money that council allocated, the money put forth for saving some of the small businesses and some of the nonprofits was critical. I mean, a lot of these folks are really hammered by COVID, by not being able to stay open, or people coming in and it just it cut their business way down. While that was a huge piece of it, you know, we also put some of that towards youth empowerment. We put it towards purchasing $8.5 million to go towards the purchasing of technology to help our law enforcement agencies in their jobs. There's a high tech, high res cameras that are now in various places throughout the community. Phase one is just about complete. We'll be moving to phase two and three right after that. Some of the cameras are going to be mobile, so they'll be able to put them in different places. So basically, if you're committing any crime, or if you are just doing illegal dumping, we'll probably get you, because we have those cameras out in a number of different places. Also went for automation. Because of some of the challenges we faced during COVID, we lost a lot of our labor supply. And as a result of that, we had to rethink the way we were delivering some services. So council was very creative in helping to authorize funds to be spent to automate some of those these services. Public art, you saw Katie, and as public art really creates an energy and a synergy within a community, and it gives it a sense of place. So seeing some of these murals that are going up, and there's some others, the one on the YMCA, AJ McClung YMCA is amazing. But seeing these public spaces splashed with color really makes you feel good about where you live. The 11th Avenue Viaduct, I think, is one of the neatest things I've seen if you've gone through it at dusk or in the evening when it gets a little darker. The capital investment in Columbus continues to stay, continues its momentum at sort of a rapid pace. We just opened, as we mentioned, we just opened the fourth hotel since COVID, and that's crazy. So the Hampton now joins the AC by Marriott, the Indigo, and City Mills up closer to the Mercer School. And then there's also Highside Market, Mid-City Yards. You probably saw a lot of these because I know council took a tour and had an opportunity to see. All of these are because of visionaries in our community that have put their efforts and their money into creating opportunities for a quality of life here in Columbus, Georgia. Uptown continues to be the heartbeat of our community. They've pumped over $200 million into the community. Just from their retail activities, Whitewater Express has had a record-breaking year. They've seen more people come through there than ever before. And of course, we saw the World Cup championships. The World Cup was here in October. And if you didn't get a chance to see that, you'll get another shot, because there'll be people from 30 different countries, probably, I don't know, 200 or 300 competitors are going to be here in October again of 2023. For the World Championships. ESPN will be here, and I know they're making a big deal out of it, gonna have a music festival that coincides with it. So it's just a lot of vitality going on in Uptown. But there's a lot of vitality in Midtown. in the Mill District. Lauren Chambers in the Mill District, Julio Portillo in Midtown, and of course, Ed Wolverton with his efforts in Uptown. Columbus Housing Authority, I know they're here. If you've been by and seen the banks, the new apartments that are going up just across the Second Avenue Bridge, I mean, public housing has become now, I think, a thing that people aspire to get into as they're moving up. So affordable housing is really changed. It's a beautiful development if you've had an opportunity to go by there. Trade Center, people are visiting Columbus, Georgia. Haley Henderson has done an incredible job at the Trade Center. Ironworks Trade Convention Center had, I think, over 600 events this past year. 169,000 people visited the Trade Center. So, if you go down to the Civic Center, and if you go over into the ball fields in South Commons, where Mary Spence always has somebody on those fields. So people are coming to Columbus, Georgia. There's an energy that is drawing people to this community. Now we have also had one of the things that I'm really proud of that we were able to do was partner with Columbus 2025. We have made an investment in 2025, as have a lot of the leaders throughout this community. And we're excited about that organization because they are our strategic plan going forward. And one of the broad goals of 2025 is poverty. 2025 and the United Way are working to reduce our poverty level. And you're going to hear more about that because that's one of the primary things that we're focusing on as a government as well. Labor. I mentioned some of the labor shortages. We're still dealing with it. Now, we did successfully, council approved a pay plan after a pay compensation study. That we had a consultant perform. And we now have a pay plan that is equitable. It was originally targeted to be about $8 million. The council wanted to make a significant impact in the areas of public safety and in the area of CDL drivers, because those were our most critical needs. So we added another $5 million to the total cost of that pay plan. But it did move our public safety officers up, where they're earning, I think police officers now, if they come in with a high school degree, they're earning over $50,000. Now that's not an end point. What it did is it got us back on track with where we need to be competing with the market. So the challenge for council and for our finance director, Angelica Alexander, as we move forward, is to continue to maintenance that plan, so that it stays vital, it stays equitable, and it stays updated. We also are facing some shortages in Parks and Recreation. That agency touches as many people in this community on a daily basis as any other organization that we have. But they're down over 100 people. Metra has been down drivers for about three years now. Matter of fact, we have been running, Metra has been operating weekend routes on weekday rides. And what that means is all the buses are still running. But whereas you used to wait for 20 minutes if you missed a bus to get the next one, now you're looking at about an hour and a half. Think about the significant impact that has on families who do not have alternative transportation. So if you miss that bus, you're now an hour and a half late to work. That puts your job in jeopardy. And these are people that can ill afford to lose those jobs. I will tell you though, I gotta give credit too to Rosa Evans. It's amazing to me. Rosa is the director of Metra. Rosa has a CDL license. Every Saturday, Rosa's going down to Metra, climbing in the driver's side of a bus, and she's running routes. That's the director of Metra that's doing that. That's the level of commitment that the directors have in the CCG. One exciting thing that we're doing with Metra, though, we are in the process of piloting an on-demand microtransit system. And the reason we're doing this is because our dial-a-ride doesn't quite have the coverage we really need it to have. You saw the Bob Poitashev Veterans Clinic as the ribbon was being cut. I'll give you a very quick story. There's a gentleman, a veteran, who is blind, who lives about a mile from there. Because that clinic is outside the dial-a-ride route, he has to take a dial-a-ride down to Linwood at the connector. Now, we made arrangements for everybody to have transportation, but this is what he has to do. He has to go down to Linwood and then catch that shuttle and ride back up to a mile from his house to go to the clinic. And that's because of some federal requirements that deal with where the dial-a-ride maximum can be based on where your regular routes are. Once this gets in place, this gentleman will be able to pull out his phone, hit an app. I don't know how you do that if he's seeing impaired, but he also can make a phone call and request that ride to come pick him up and just go the 1 mile to there. So we'll have, hopefully we'll be able to get that piloted in action very soon with that the microtransit. And speaking of piloting programs, Ed Wolverton and his folks in Uptown, we've already received one or two of the 8-person golf carts. Going to start a service that will allow shuttles down in the Uptown area so that if people want to go from a hotel down to a restaurant or over to a nightclub or wherever they want to go within that area, they'll be able to use an app to call that shuttle to come pick them up. This will also have a tremendous positive impact on the safety of the folks that are parking in the garages, because now the shuttle can take them right inside the garage, right up to their car. Lots of the good things that you saw in there, but we still have challenges. We mentioned right at the very beginning, crime is, and gun violence in particular is one of our biggest challenges. And we've talked about the fact that we are working with law enforcement to make sure that we provide them with all the resources they need to do their job. But that's not going to stop. We could have a police officer on every corner, and just about every one of those instances over the weekend would have occurred anyway, just because of the nature and down in a street on somebody's driveway or in a hotel room or some other areas that are off the beaten path. So we've got to really focus as a community and getting in and trying to stop some of this activity that is leading to these young people making the kind of decisions they're making. Housing, and everybody's talking about affordable housing. It's talked about in the legislature, and most of you hear it. It's sort of the new buzzword. Everybody knows there's an affordable housing issue, right? But nobody really has a real clear idea of how to solve it. There are a lot of different approaches. And one of the things that I don't know if Pat Frey is here, but I know that Pat had indicated she is working on putting together a group that will serve as sort of a task force to begin to talk about putting together a strategic plan. In my opinion, what needs to happen with that strategic plan is it needs to be revisited every 2 years, because the economy changes so quickly. The nature of the housing industry, cost of materials, they're in constant state of flux. So it needs to be checked on every 2 years in order to really get focused on trying to provide affordable housing. We're also seeing a little bit of a spike in the homeless population. Again, and I do see Pat, she at the point in time count this last year, we'd seen an uptick. And it's some of that has to do with how difficult it is to find affordable housing that people can get in. Others is just people that are choosing to live the way they live. But she does an incredible job and continues to try to look for ways to service those people. Also mentioned, we also had a SPLOST passed, and our city manager likes to use this number, and it's accurate, that at the end of our 10-year T-SPLOST, we will have spent over $1 billion on infrastructure projects. Our SPLOST that the citizens voted in was a no-frills SPLOST. It was a back to basics. It was replacing things that had worn out over 25, 30 years, and it was refurbishing things that were in disrepair. We put it on, I think the only thing we added that was new was 5 splash pads. And the reason those got in there and council approved putting those in is because if you've ever been by Banks Food Hall, you've seen that splash pad out there. It is the most utilized, the most diverse area on that riverwalk during the summer. And we saw how much pleasure it gave the kids, and the parents could let the kids go. You didn't need a lifeguard. You and it stayed open longer than the regular pools do. So we're going to try to put five of those in neighborhoods to try to give those neighborhoods sort of a sense of community, a sense of place. And kids that otherwise didn't have easy access to the pools will now have some place they can go and hang out. We are replacing the pools. We're putting, I think, $44 million towards public safety. We've got $48 million going towards parks and recreation. $25 million going towards transportation. And by transportation, we're really talking about roads and sidewalks. So it's back to basics with that. So we will have invested $1.1 billion at the end of the T-SPLOST in infrastructure. It referred to the new City Hall. In June, you'll see the first wave of non-judicial folks move into the new City Hall, which is the old Synovus building, which, by the way, is going to be the cornerstone of one of the most aggressive capital projects we've seen in Columbus that I can remember. I can't remember any other time when I've looked out my window and seen two cranes working on the same project. And I don't mean it, well, I'm not counting the birds. I'm talking about two cranes on the book. So it's going to be the cornerstone. With them with Synovus moving in there, we're taking over that that facility. And we're excited about the opportunities it presents. It allows us to create some synergy and a streamlined option for people looking to start businesses because we'll have all of our people in one place. And we can get instant feedback and continue to tweak that. There's no reason why we shouldn't be the easiest city in Georgia to do business in. Georgia touts itself as the best state in America to do business in. Well, why don't we step up and tell them we want to be the best city within that state to do to business in? So these are some things that we can work on. A couple of challenges for the coming year. We mentioned that infrastructure is going to be a focus for us. We're also going to be focusing on economic development and the creation of jobs. If you talk about poverty and trying to have a serious impact in poverty, you've got to talk about jobs. And to talk about those jobs, you've got to talk about creating the skills in people so that they can take those jobs. We've got a lot of organizations that have been working real hard. True Springs has done a great job with some of the construction workers and their culinary workers that they've put through their program. They've got another group going. Right now, I sat next to a gentleman that's in the class at the Celebration for Habitat for Humanity. So True Springs is doing a great job. Construction Ready is an organization that the Chamber has, I know, partnered with to try to turn out young people who go, or not just young people, anybody that goes through the program looking to repurpose their skill set, graduated right into jobs. So between that and, of course, our traditional work skill development folks in our university at CSU and, of course, Columbus Technical College. Martha Ann Todd has done an incredible job at looking for ways to be nimble enough to create those skills so that they are tailor-made for the different organizations that they're filling. The warden of the Muskogee County Prison and Martha Ann have had a couple of programs on campus. So there are prisoners that have gotten certificates in welding, in OSHA, and in forklift driving. So when they get out of prison, now they've got a marketable skill that they can put to use, and they won't end up, hopefully, right back in the prison pipeline. We're going to be focusing, too, the next year on health and safety. Safety, obviously, is the public safety piece that we're going to continue to work with. And keep in mind that as we spend money on resources for our police department and our sheriff's department, as well as resources for programs, our crime prevention board, which is a group of citizens, as you saw, I think, in the film, contributed $750,000 to organizations who have as their focus reducing crime. Reggie and his group with Cure Violence, I know council agreed to fund them to try to help get them up and running so that they could become self-sustaining by seeking donations. But we're excited about the opportunity that they represent too. But we also talk about healthcare. And I tell you, Columbus is blessed with a number of healthcare facilities that just go above and beyond. Piedmont, St. Francis, they have done an incredible job. During the COVID pandemic, I was amazed. I mean, frontline medical workers were heroes, and the administrators were magicians at being able to keep everything flowing despite all the challenges that were created. But we have an opportunity now to change the way we do indigent care. All of those organizations, those two hospitals, plus the Mercy Meds, the Valley Healthcare, and other organizations, the Bradley Center, mental health issues, all of those will have an opportunity to bid on the indigent care funds as they provide those services to the to our folks. We're also going to finally roll out the Mayor's Health Commission, Chattahoochee Health Commission. We've got Dr. Stephen Leichter and Phil Schuler, who are co-chairing that, two different pronged approach. One is going to be to an education piece, an advocacy piece that Stephen Leichter is doing. And then Phil has got a mobile unit that's going to go out to these underserved areas. They'll be taking a mobile farmer's market. They'll be taking a healthcare screening facility so they can go out there and get some data and try to get some of these people a little bit healthier so they can get joined the workforce. I'm going to stop there. I know I should have stopped about 10 minutes ago, Rodney. I think I've got most of them asleep, so they won't hear us as we move forward. But I'm going to introduce the chair of the Columbus Chamber of Commerce, Rodney Close, and my interviewer.
See ya. You turn on?
Should I turn it back off?
Thanks, Gerald. Well, good afternoon. Thank you. We are in the South, right?
Is it evening?
Good. Well, Mayor, thanks for coming in and spending some time with us today. And so just want to really and truly just kind of go through a little exercise that we did a year ago. And and other than that, we'll kind of go from there. So this is your second term.
Mm-hmm.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So what do you think?
Well, I think this will be, by law, this will be my last term, because they won't let you run again, and she's not going to let me run again anyway. So, I will tell you, it's changed a lot.
Right.
I mean, from not just the time when I started back in 18, whatever it was, but even just over the last few years, I think it's gotten tougher, not only to run, but tougher to serve. I think some of that is due to the information, the access to information that people have. And the others is that we've seen government at a very high level, I think, get very partisan.
Gotcha, good. So I understand in your second term, you have four pillars on which you want to focus on. Can you share that with the group here?
Yeah, we've touched on just a few of them. The overarching objective for us is poverty, trying to help. I know Ben Moser's out there with United Way, and we've partnered kind of with them as well in trying to have an impact on that, because if we don't impact the poverty rate, then we're going to continue to struggle in a lot of different areas. And the ways we've decided to go after that is making sure that our infrastructure is sound, that people are connected, that commerce can flow back and forth through our community. We also have talked about the health and safety piece. We really do believe that if we're unable to try to provide access, as our hospital folks know, if you can't try to keep a healthy community, it's difficult for them to be able to find jobs and be productive. And the other, it's affordable housing. We've got to, if we're going to bring workers in, we got to have places our employees can live. And then the last one was economic development and creating those jobs. So we're going to be focusing on those four things with the objective of impacting the poverty.
Okay. So over the past few years, do you feel there's been somewhat of a decline in the trust in the government?
But you wouldn't believe me.
Let me get to the second one.
Okay.
If so, what does that look from a local government perspective, and what effects that have on the community?
We mentioned a little bit about it sooner. Yeah, I think there is a little distrust of the government, and I think it's, in my opinion, it's been difficult for our federal legislators to operate, because there has been so much partisanship. and so much division, and there have been people who will really dig their heels in the sand, and they've given up searching for the middle ground.
Gotcha.
And at the local level, where that manifests itself, I think the trust is a little better because of the immediate accountability. Mm-hmm. I mean, these counselors, they have their constituents approach them at church, the grocery store, on a walk, taking the dog mm-hmm. for the walk. So there is an instant accountability that breeds a little bit extra transparency. But you know, I think that it's going to be a while before the healing takes place. It needs to take place, not just in government, but across the country.
Gotcha. Okay. Good. So do you just think it's just a lack of, I mean, somewhat of a lack of trust in certain areas, or
you know,
more than others?
I said back when we were dealing with some of the effects of leaving mm-hmm. or sort of getting out of the pandemic, that I felt like everybody I see is operating from a base of fear. Mm-hmm. The interesting thing, though, is that some are afraid things will never change,
yeah.
and others are afraid things might change. So I think when people relax and realize that we all want the same things, mm-hmm. we just have a little bit different idea of how to move towards them, I think it will improve tremendously as that happens.
So let's talk public safety. And I think, you know, Friday night, Saturday, this entire weekend has been on the minds of all of us, you know, where, you know, we lay our heads down at night and we think we're going to, you know, really we're safe in our community. And so what specific strategies has your administration recently employed to fight crime in our community?
Well, we've actually met yesterday with the police chief and with the sheriff again, and we meet regularly. The sheriff has gotten some strategies that he's utilizing right now that's with an emphasis on gangs. Mm-hmm. We do have gang members in Columbus, Georgia. And the important thing to do with those gang members is to be able to validate them, because what that'll allow us to do when we pick them up, mm-hmm. we can take them to a federal court. And then they have, number one, they have to do day for day for their sentence. They don't get any slack cut to them. And the other is, there's a good chance they'll get shipped out of the Muskogee County area. Police chief has been utilizing his crime suppression unit, some other strategies and tactics we have put in place this year has been the technology piece. We have tried to increase some personnel on the street because our numbers are down, by offering stipends to individuals who want to pick up an extra shift. And council has done a great job about trying to figure out what resources they need to be able to accomplish that.
Gotcha. So as from a hiring, can you help us understand this hiring shortage? I mean, I know the company comp package has kind of been put together in the works, sort of recruiting. So what are we doing to recruit more officers? I think I heard last week, maybe 200 something employees, officers that are in our community, right. really trying to protect us, which is a shortage of where we were probably years ago.
We have lost officers. And the hiring challenge is the same hiring challenge that exists with almost every industry right now. I mean, we've got a 3.3% unemployment rate. So anybody that wants a job has it. I mean, the people who we're trying to identify where a lot of those workers went, but we don't struggle as bad with the hiring. The challenge with the police department is that you've got to be very careful in your screening. So it'll take 100 applications to get just one or two police officers, because by the time you go through background, criminal background, drug testing and psychological analysis, because we got to make sure we're putting the right folks on the street.
I got you. Good. So do you think with this new, I guess, pay opportunity for officers, you think that's going to be able to draw pretty,
you know, it'll help, okay. but people who are leaving and people who are retiring, it's not all about pay. It's you know, there's morale challenges anytime you get in a public safety arena, and there are other things that mean as much to them as the pay. Now they want the pay because you gotta pay those folks what they're worth. And the challenge you have is when we were working, when council was working on this this pay plan, there were other communities at the same time moving it up. So while we gained some ground and actually leapfrogged most of the people in our area, you know, the minute after it's approved, you have another community, I'll see you're 52 and bump you to 55. So we've got to continue to monitor things that are important to the police department. You know, just look for some other things that we can do to try to make them not want to leave Columbus, Georgia.
So as we look, the second largest city in Georgia, as opposed to the, everything in Atlanta, are we pretty competitive?
For pay? When you get into to Atlanta.
Well, I know that's a different ballgame.
They pay a little more. And I think the interesting thing is we've seen some of the smaller communities, smaller cities that have a much, much lower poverty rate and a higher tax base. They're paying more, but we are competitive. We for a long time we were a little behind others, but we are competitive. We're right next. I said we're like $50,000, a little over $50,000
gotcha.
For a police officer with a high school education coming in right off the street, and we will pay somebody if they join and they had some experience in another police department. We'll pay them and plug them in at that level.
Okay, gotcha. So how can the community get engaged?
Volunteer Boys and Girls Club. I mean, not being facetious, they can get engaged by picking an organization that is pouring into kids. And what you were telling me about before we got on stage, what an amazing evening that was, the same night as these kids were being shot at. So first thing they can do is if they see something, say something. And that's easier said than done. But you got to understand that there are anonymous tip lines, both at the sheriff's department and the police department. If you don't want to give your name, don't give your name. But it's hard to believe that people, kids that are out there carrying these guns, somebody didn't notice something. A sibling or a parent or a neighbor or somebody didn't notice something that if they'd have just picked up the phone and called it in, it might have stopped what happened.
So Skip and I was talking, excuse me, the mayor, sorry.
No, Skip's fine, I answered that.
Excuse me, my apology. We were talking.
That's better than what I've been called lately, so it's fine.
Well, he and I were we were actually standing in the line, and we were talking about Friday night. And Friday night, as we think about it now, was really just horrible in a lot of ways because we all have kids, nephews, grandkids, and we were talking about that night at one of our South Columbus Club in, off Casita Road. Tavares, you mind standing up? I hate to blast you out here, but we had a teen get together of about 55 teenagers at the South Columbus Club, playing basketball, dancing, eating, having fun, 3-point shootout. Reggie, where's Reggie at? Reggie, could you stand as well? So Skip, the mayor and I were talking, we gotta do more of this. You know, it's, the kids left at 9:30, they were safe, parents picked them up. We gotta figure out how we can really and truly help them along the way. The mayor and I was talking, Mayor Dickens up in Atlanta, I'm sure many of you have seen the AJC article where it's the youth, it's the year of the youth. That's their that's his platform, and the mayor's great, but their platform is the year of the youth. We've got to figure out a way, not to get on my soapbox here, but we have to figure out a way how we can pour into our youth. You know, some are, I mean, they come in all different sizes. So,
that's the significance of this, though, is you've got people like Rodney who are committed and who are passionate about young people, and you know we put in about $750,000 a year into different programs. Call Seth Brown, ask him if any one of those programs needs some assistance. Ben Moser's right back there. I guarantee if you stop him, say, "What do you know of any of the organizations, the United Way, that need some volunteers?" He's going to put you in touch with somebody.
Yeah.
Call your pastor. Every church has some type of outreach program going on. It's a choice for the community.
You can stand on the sidelines and complain about the loss of life, or you can get involved. And you don't have to get up to your neck in the involvement either. You can get involved just to whatever level you feel comfortable. But frankly, that is what it's going to take if we're going to try to cut off the food supply for these kids that are just making really dumb decisions every time they get in an argument.
Next question. Why is it taking Cure Violence so long to just really...
Reggie's out playing basketball with you.
Thank you, Reggie.
No. You know, do I wish it was happening faster? Absolutely. Yeah. But am I comforted by the fact that they're being very deliberate and intentional about how they structure their employment base and how they create that plan to go out in the community? Yeah, I am. Because you don't want to rush it to market and then have it fail because you moved too quickly. So I personally feel better about the fact that they're not going to start really pumping into the community until they get, and they have hired folks. They've got an executive director now, and we're excited for what they're going to do. I think, and in Reggie's defense, I think people need to remember that it's not like flipping a light switch.
Yeah.
This is not something that's designed to the minute you hang your shingle, crime goes down. That's not how that works.
That's true.
It's a cultural deal. It's a long, slow turn.
Okay, good. Well, let's switch our gears to jobs. On the Columbus 2025 Amazing Careers website, there are 1,600 advertised job openings. The unemployment rate in the Columbus metro area is 3.5%, which is down a whole percent since the last year. How do you feel about the employment outlook for the Columbus region?
Well, look, there are jobs. Call Reether. At the municipal government, she'll put you in a job. I think the challenge that we have, and every community has, is making sure that the skill sets exist that can take the jobs on. And a lot of folks are constantly looking for their first job. We get excited about the Mayor's Summer Youth Employment Program because it teaches. We target kids who are maybe seniors and they don't have a school that they're enrolled in to go to college, and they don't have a plan for a job when they leave. So what we've tried to do, and we started with about 20 or 30 last time, we got up to about 60. We'd love to do three times that many, but the idea is to try to get folks involved in the soft skills and some of those things that they're doing.
Gotcha. So you guys are feeling some of the impacts on that as well.
We are.
Definitely. Okay. So let's talk economic development and business attraction.
Okay.
So the,
I think we have to talk quick. I think he's
10 minutes. Okay.
That's really 10 seconds. That's better.
10 seconds or 10 minutes?
No, 10 minutes.
10 minutes. 10 minutes. So the Columbus Chamber of Development Authority had some solid wins over the last 3 years, like the announcement of the new pet food company, AFB International, along with the expansion of Kaiser Warren and PathTech. Why is it so important for the mayor and the city to be in attracting economic development in Columbus?
That's the lifeblood. I mean, you've got to maintain a wide and very diverse option for jobs so that you can continue to attract a very wide and diverse constituency. But yeah, we're anxious to do whatever the chamber needs us to do. The chamber's got a robust pipeline.
Gotcha.
And so what we just need council and the mayor, when called upon, need to be willing to go out there and try to help close it.
Gotcha. Good. You want to talk about redevelopment in our communities, downtown, housing areas?
Yeah, we are blessed with, I mentioned earlier, the visionaries. I mean, you've got, and I'll probably leave somebody out, but you got the Ken Hensons, you got the Jason Gamaches, you've got Chris Woodruff. You've got the folks, Chris Whiteman out at Midland. You got all of these folks that have this outstanding vision for development. What we see going up the Second Avenue corridor is just incredible. And if you look at True Spring, what they're doing buying houses along Sixth Avenue, it gets closer to Wilson Apartments. I think what we've seen is champions take on those tasks. Yeah. And the opportunity for the city is when you build a successful story, now you've got a template and you've got a roadmap to pick that up and take it to a Casita Road, pick that up and take it to an Oakland Park. And the challenge, find another champion that's going to make sure they stay on their point.
Sure. Sure. And so I'm going to wrap this up a little bit here. So,
okay.
Anything else you want to add?
No, I will. You know, I would just say that, right now in the city of Columbus, people are hurting. My wife will tell you if you ask her in private that it I had a rough time this weekend with what went on, and we have to continue to pull together as a community, continue to look for opportunities to do what the Boys and Girls Club do, to do what some of the Springer programs do, to do what some of these other organizations that are funded by Seth and the crime prevention do. And we've also got to support our law enforcement. We have to make sure they have all the resources they need to be able to do what they do. But all that said, this is an amazing community to live in. The state of Columbus is still strong. We're still riding momentum, and we're still moving forward. We have challenges like everybody else. And the way we meet them is the way we meet some of our opportunities. And that's by working together.
Thank you. Well, we appreciate you.
Yep, thank you.
Appreciate you. You and your family as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
I told him to shut those mics off before I turn this one back on so I don't blow everybody's eardrums out. Let's have another round of applause for the mayor. Thank you, Rodney. Once again, good afternoon. I'm Brian Salito. I'm the Vice President of Partnership and Engagement at the Chamber. I want to thank, obviously, our presenting sponsor, Paige Cranham. We cannot do events without the support of our sponsors. Of course, our gold sponsors, AT&T and Georgia Power and Liberty, and our silver and welcome sponsors as well. Of course, we would always want to thank our cornerstone investors in Aflac and Georgia Power, Piedmont Synovus, TSIS, a global payments company, and W.C. Bradley. We'd, of course, be remiss if we didn't thank Columbus State University for their partnership year after year on this event. This amazing setup, courtesy of Steve Morse and his team, Dr. Fuchko, Interim President of Columbus State. We appreciate this ongoing partnership. And of course, I want to thank, as Gerald mentioned, our chamber team. I want to specifically recognize our new events coordinator, Becca Brabston, and of course, our partnership coordinator, Jamie Spencer, and our sponsorship coordinator, Ashley Chisholm, for their work on this event. Of course, I want to thank all of you who joined us today. I mean, we got 300 people in the room, and I'd be remiss if I didn't let you know about the Chamber's Small Business Boot Camp that's coming up. Maybe you know some folks who are involved in small business, and we'd love for you to let them know about our boot camp presented by Choose Columbus, set for March the 23rd, right here on the CSU campus at the Elizabeth Bradley Turner Center. We're gonna have roundtable discussions with subject matter experts to help entrepreneurs and small business owners not only start, but also grow and scale their businesses. It's $99. It includes a light breakfast and lunch, and that early bird pricing ends on March the 8th. We also hope to see all of you at our State of Fort Benning event. It'll be in your backyard, Colonel Malley, on March the 31st at the National Infantry Museum. And we'll get to hear from the commanding general at Fort Benning, Major General Curtis Buzzard. And certainly we want you to spread the word about and join us for the best business networking golf tournament in Columbus. That's our partnership golf tournament on May 5th. That's Cinco de Mayo at Maple Ridge. New format, still lots of fun, but you don't have to play golf to participate, because this year we're incorporating an all-day drop-in Cinco de Mayo networking event at the clubhouse from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. It'll be a lot of fun. Of course, tickets are available at our website for all of our events, columbusgachamber.com. We are not on the TikTok, but please connect with us on Facebook and Instagram. Have a great afternoon, everybody. Thanks for being here.